Eyewitness News and the Providence Journal bring you live coverage. Now, Campaign 2014, the Providence Mayoral Debate.
Live from Rhode Island College, a televised debate among the candidates for Providence Mayor. Good evening, I'm Tim White. The race to be the next mayor of Providence is one of the marquee matchups of 2014, attracting statewide as well as national attention. Over the next hour, we'll try and help you identify the differences between the three candidates looking for your vote. And they are, from left to right on your screen, Independent Vincent Cianci, Democrat Jorge Elorza, and Republican Daniel Harrop. We'll hear from them in a moment. For the next 60 minutes, we'll be going in depth. This debate is airing live right now on Fox Providence and online WPRI.com. I'll be moderating this debate and asking the questions along with our panel, WPRI.com reporter Ted Nisi, and from our news partner, the Providence Journal, Ed Fitzpatrick. We're going to begin with 1 minute opening remarks from each of the candidates. I want to ask the audience to hold your applause until the very end of the debate so everyone here at Rhode Island College, as well as those watching at home, can hear what the candidates have to say. Now, the order for opening statements was determined by a drawing. We begin with Vincent Cianci. Most recently, Mr. Cianci was a radio talk show host at WPRO. Prior to that, he was mayor of Providence for 22 years over two different periods. Mr. Cianci is a graduate of Fairfield University, Villanova, and Marquette University School of Law. Mr. Cianci, your opening remarks.
Thank you very much, Tim, and thank you very much to the audience that's here, and also to the Journal, and also Channel 12 and Fox. And my worthy opponents, good evening. I'm running for mayor to rebuild Providence's greatness. As I campaign across our city, everyone I meet has a story to tell. A mother wondering why her child is trapped in a failing school. A senior citizen being priced out of his home by high taxes. A woman terrified to put her trash out at night after her neighbor was mugged at gunpoint. And an unemployed college graduate who wonders if she'll have to leave the city of Providence to find a job. These are the stories of a city that's on the wrong track, a city that has suffered through 10 years, 12 years of failed policies and weak leadership. This campaign is about who can solve these problems and who has the experience. My opponent is endorsed and supported by the same people who put the city in its current state of decline. He wants to make this a race about personalities. I'm making it about solving problems. Tonight, you'll get to hear more about my solutions, how they are different from my opponents, and how we can put Providence back on the right track.
Thank you, Mr. Cianci. Now, Jorge Elorza. Most recently, Mr. Elorza was a housing court judge for the city of Providence. A lawyer, he has worked for Rhode Island Legal Services and is a professor at Roger Williams University School of Law. He's a graduate of the University of Rhode Island and Harvard Law School. Mr. Elorza, your opening remarks.
Thank you. Thank you, Tim, and good evening, everyone. My name is Jorge Elorza, and I'm running for mayor because I want Providence to be a city of opportunity. When my parents came to this country, they came here with nothing. But they played by the rules, and they busted their tail, and little by little worked their way up to the middle class. Those opportunities, they've long since disappeared. I'm running for mayor because I want to bring jobs back to the city, and I want to bring economic prosperity back to every neighborhood in our city. While my parents worked in the factories, I went through the public schools, and many people know that I barely graduated, and I got rejected from every university that I applied to. But people believed in me. I ended up graduating first in my class as an accountant at URI and went off to Harvard Law School. I'm running for mayor to provide those same opportunities for others so that every single child has the opportunity to achieve their dreams. And last, I'm running for mayor because honest leadership matters. And I'm looking to bring a new direction and a change to City Hall.
Thank you, Mr. Elorza. Now, Daniel Harrop. Dr. Harrop has had a private practice in psychiatry since 1983. He's also worked on the staff at Butler and Rhode Island hospitals. Mr. Harrop is a graduate of Brown University in what is now known as the Warren Alpert Medical School at Brown. Mr. Harrop, your opening remarks.
Good evening. I am Daniel Harrop, and I'm the Republican candidate for mayor of Providence. Providence is looking to restore jobs and its educational system. It is looking for an ethical and experienced administrator for mayor. We Republicans will present tonight radical but not reckless plans to promote educational choice and job growth, eliminate the car tax, reduce the near highest in the nation commercial tax rate, all while restoring police to the streets and saving our pension fund. While the other candidates will make grand promises to you, we Republicans have practical and workable plans, and we will tell you how to fund them. And I think you'll notice the difference. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Harrop, and thank you to all the candidates. Let's get to the topics at hand. As all three of you know, there is no strict format to tonight's debate. We're looking for an open and honest discussion of the issues. I will allow for some back and forth. In fact, I encourage it as long as it's with the topic on hand. We have a lot of ground to cover, and I'm trying to keep fair time here. So if I feel you're going too long or you're not answering the question, I will jump in. Let's begin. Look, we have a lot of issues to discuss tonight. You hit up on many of them: schools, crime, the difficult financial situation facing the city. But first, let's tackle the topic that has been front and center from the beginning, at least since June, and that is Mr. Cianci's entrance into the race. Mr. Elorza, at a recent forum, you said, and I quote, "I think it's an embarrassment that Mr. Cianci is running for mayor. Our poll from last week shows Mr. Cianci's in the lead with 38%. If he's such an embarrassment, why are more than one in three voters supporting him?"
Why are more than two in three voters not supporting him, or close to two in three? You know, that's truly the question. We have a clear choice in this campaign. We can vote for honest leadership that moves the city forward, or we can go back to the failed and corrupt politics of the past. But you know what? Today I'd like to focus on our vision for the city. Let's leave behind all of the corruption and what led the ex-mayor to go to jail. Today, let's focus on the policies. Now, in the last 6 years of Cianci's administration, violent crime was down in the United States. It was down in the region. It was down in Rhode Island, but it was up in Providence. We had a police department that was plagued by scandal, a cheating scandal, a promotion scandal. It was under investigation by the Department of Justice. You know, my opponent talks a great deal about a city that we can be proud of, but that's hardly something that we can be proud of. I provide honest leadership for the future, and I have a forward-thinking vision to create jobs, to fix our schools, to keep our streets safe, and to change the culture at City Hall.
Mr.
That's
Elorza,
what this election has to be about.
We're gonna, I obviously have to have Mr. Cianci respond to some of that, but real quick, I'm just trying to gauge your level of embarrassment from what you said in the forum. If Mr. Cianci wins in November, are you going to be so embarrassed that you're going to move out of the city of Providence?
You know, every day people tell me that exact same thing. Look, I'm invested in the city. I'm not going on anywhere. I'm going to make sure that I do everything I can in my small and large ways to make this the great city that it can be. And knock on wood, if I have the honor of earning the vote of the voters in Providence, I'll do that over the next 4 and 8 years as the mayor here in the city of Providence.
Mr. Cianci, you've heard some tough words there, but I mean, I don't think it'll come to surprise to you that a lot of people feel the same way that he does. So I want you to respond.
Well, let me tell you this. I've made mistakes in my life. I'm sorry for them. I'm humbled by them. And I can tell you that I've learned from them. A lot's happened to my life in the last 12 years. I lost my liberty, number one. I lost my daughter. I battled cancer. And that's changed me. I take care of my grandkids. And I can tell you that I've made mistakes. But there were no mistakes in the area of developing the city of Providence, creating jobs when I was mayor. Providence was one of the five Renaissance cities in America, according to USA Today in those days. Money Magazine said it was the fifth best city to live in America. In addition to that, the All Cities Almanac said in 1994, I believe, it was the safest city in America to live in. We had a police department that did a great job. Yes, there were some problems with it, but we had policemen on the street. The policemen that I had hired in those days, and they've endorsed me today. And I'm proud to have the endorsement of the individuals who run into, who police our streets every day, who save lives. And just this morning, they had lockdowns at one of the schools because we haven't done what we had to do to preserve our safety in this city.
And we're going to talk a lot about that, Mr. Cianci, but you quickly pivoted off it. And, you know, the poll we had showed that 63% of the voters are very or somewhat concerned about your prior conviction. It is important to them. Do you feel like you should apologize to all of them, to everyone in the city of Providence, for your last administration?
I'm not apologizing for my last administration and the good work that all the people in this city did. Not only did
How about how it ended?
It didn't end in a pleasant way. There's no question about it. And I do apologize, number one. Number two, I've learned from it. I've been humbled by it. Now, we can spend the whole debate talking about that and what it was like. But I've changed my attitude in many ways. I've learned a lot. And I think that the city of Providence will benefit from that. I think I'm the most experienced candidate here. Let's not forget the record of achievement and accomplishment that was done back in the 90s when I was mayor. Not only did we move rivers, not only did we build Providence Place Mall, we embraced the Arts District. I was a mayor for everybody. I was the first mayor, I think, in the country, maybe certainly in Rhode Island, to make sure that gays who worked for the city had health benefits.
Mr. Harrop, I'd like you to weigh in on this.
I was very strong on
that. I'd like you to weigh in. Do you accept the apology from Mr. Cianci?
I can accept the policy, but I have trouble believing it. Mr. Cianci's administration, far from being a golden age in Providence, set us up for the insolvency that we're in now at this point. He's the one who signed a consent decree for 6% COLAs. He didn't fund the pension. And as a result, we have a $2 billion pension deficit that is a yoke around the city's neck and is driving us down. I think that the people, 40% want him because it's sort of the devil you know rather than the devil you don't know at this particular time.
Well, let me tell you,
I ran for mayor some 8 years ago, but not well known. Jorge Elorza was essentially unknown 6 months ago. I think as the young people discover that Mr. Cianci has a half-century history of recurrent, thuggish, criminal behavior, those numbers will change.
Mr. Harrop, before I allow you to respond, Mr. Cianci, please. And I will, I have a question for you. A lot of people feel that you actually help Mr. Cianci by being in this race, and you've been sort of wishy-washy about whether or not you're going to stay in or if you're going to leave. Can you guarantee tonight, right here, that you'll be in the race on November 4th?
Nobody can guarantee any of us will be in the race November the 4th. I have bought media time through November the 4th. I have set up public appearances through November the 4th. I fully intend to stay in. I could fall, break my hip, and the Providence Republican chair might have to appoint Bob Healy to replace me. I really don't know.
Okay. All right, Mr. Cianci, obviously, I'm going to give you 30 seconds here to respond.
Well, if you want to hear about Dr. Harrop's wonderful statements that he made about me, I commend you to read a book called Health versus Wealth. And it was written by Steve Anderson. Go to page 159, I believe, of that book, and you'll find out that Dr. Harrop was fined, the company he worked with was fined $66,000 for putting profits before patient care. Here's what he did. He would get a bonus if the people he managed only saw people who had psychiatric problems three or four times when they were supposed to see them 15 or 20 times.
Mr. Harrop,
what happened was he was kicked out of the office and he spent, and in addition to that, had to pay $66,000 in legal fees for the Rhode Island Department of Health.
Those charges were completely, they were charged, they were completely investigated.
Did you pay the fine?
You could go online to the Board of Medical Licensure in any state of the 10 that I have licenses in and find nothing. No complaints at all against me, no hits on my record, as opposed to Mr. Cianci, who's been disbarred.
Well,
all right,
Andrews' book, 159,
we're going to move on to a topic that, Mr. Harrop, you had brought up. And I want to remind the audience, before this goes off the rails, it is very difficult to hear on this stage, so we're asking you to keep it down until the very end of this debate. We're going to go to a question from WPRI.com reporter Ted Nisi. Ted.
I want to keep things exciting by talking about pensions. A big reason for the problems in the city's finances is the city's heavily underfunded pension system. Mr. Cianci, I'll start with you on this one. City records do show your administration did not put the full amount of money the pension fund needed into the pension fund during six of your final 7 years as mayor, and the pension shortfall in the city nearly quadrupled during your last administration to more than $500 million. Do you agree that your failure to fund the pension system is part of why Providence is in its current financial crisis?
Let me answer this way. Number one, I was out of office in 1989. I was in office, and the retirement board of the city of Providence, Ted, voted themselves to give themselves a 5% and 6% COLA. I went to court. The city went to court to stop that. During the course of that litigation, we were advised by lawyers and by people. We didn't make decisions Professor, this isn't the classroom where you can tell your students what to do. This is a political debate.
Need the question.
You know, that's what
need
it
answer.
Is. Am I allowed to finish the
keep
question,
going,
Ted? Thank you. I have to start from the beginning.
But we're only in 1989. Keep going.
Okay, 1989. Yeah, all right. Thanks. It should be a longer show. I told you that before. We took the retirement board to court. I was advised, in order to keep the system whole, that we would fight that in court, and we did. Does anybody here think that I said, oh yeah, I want to give 5% and 6% pensions out? That's not what the intent was. The intent was to take care of individuals who were making $80 and $100 a month in the pension system. They were older firefighters, and that's who they were. And they had stories to tell.
Mr. Cianci, you signed that consent decree. Yes, it led to this large gap, and then you did not put the money in
because the class was expanded, Ted. We didn't realize the way it was written that the law would interpret it, that would include many other firefighters.
But
we went to court,
and
it stopped eventually. The case went through the system. We stopped eventually. And then we put a plan together to make sure that that eventually became funded.
But even in your final year, you didn't put in the full amount
of money.
We
had a plan. We couldn't. When the verdict came down, or the judgment came down, we would have had to come up with $16 million. And if we had put money in that pension system, we would have told the court we could afford it. And we didn't want to do that because we were challenging it. That's number one. Number two, we made sure that when we did find out it was going to cost us, we put a plan together that would go. In fact, that plan is still in effect today. It started, I believe, in the late 90s, and we funded it. And the finance director was on PolitiFact and check and said the same thing, that we funded it to the plan that we had agreed to, the city council, myself, and others. And we finally got up to 100% funding and 80% funding in 2002. And then later on, obviously the plan was followed.
It was 60% funding, Mr. Cianci. It was 61% funded. The amount of money you put in 2002 was 60.6%.
66. And then the next, well, wait a minute. My budget went from 2002 to 2003, basically.
64% in 2003.
Yeah, so it was up there. But it was the plan that wasn't 100%. Never said it was 100%. And if I misled you, I'm sorry. What we did was put a plan together to reach that number as time went on.
All right, Mr. Elorza, I want to bring you into this. Records show that after the various steps taken by Mayor Taveras, who is supporting you, the city pension fund is still more than $800 million in the red and only about a third funded. Are you satisfied that Mr. Taveras did enough to solve the problem?
Look, by no means are we out of the woods in this. You know, we still have to dig ourselves out. And the only way we're going to get out of this over the long term is by broad-based economic growth. And that's why, from day one, I've had an aggressive jobs creation program, starting with the Port of Providence and the working waterfront, learning from best practices from cities such as Pittsburgh, best practices cities such as Portland, Oregon. If we do this right and fully utilize our port, we can expand our exports twofold and create as many as 1,500 jobs here in the city.
But do you think
we have to dig ourselves out of this hole? And creating jobs and bringing them back to the city is the only way to do so. You know, and Mr. Cianci, he'll, you know, try to wiggle his way out of this. But the facts are extremely clear, and it's simple. The decision that he made led to 5 and 6% compounded COLAs. Now, we have a retiree that's collecting a $17,000 paycheck a month. $17,000 paycheck a month, tax-free. How many families in Providence don't make $17,000 a year? But we're paying this out of our tax dollars. If we're complaining about our high property taxes, if we're complaining about our high car taxes, and if we're complaining about our high commercial tax rates, we have to look at the bad financial decisions that were made during Mr. Cianci's administration as a start. It's failed leadership. I'm an accountant. I provide honest leadership going forward and a jobs plan to bring jobs back to the city and set the city of Providence on a new path.
Mr. Cianci, I'll give you 30 seconds before we bring in Mr.
That's all, 30 seconds. Okay. First of all, if you're going to have economic development in the city, you have to have safety, public safety. People have got to feel safe if they're going to bring a business here. Number two, we've got to stabilize our tax rate. We've got to streamline the regulatory process. And we have to have a workforce that has skill sets that industry will want. And, you know, concerning the Port of Providence, I have a plan that I'll be unveiling. My campaign hired an architectural firm of very, very great renown to do that plan. And we have a big difference as to how that port should be developed. We now have scrap yards and strip clubs there that the people who are supporting him put there.
All right.
That's number one.
That's a 30
second. I'm not so sure that's the case.
Oh, yeah. Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Mr. Harrop, I want to bring you
into this. You can't make things up, buddy. We're not going to let you get away.
Isn't Mayor Taveras?
You can speak, buddy, but you can't lie.
Isn't Mr. Solomon on your side?
We're not going to let
you lie. He's the one that passed the ordinance
to put
scrap metal out there.
Thank you.
Isn't he supporting you?
Thank you.
Let me just...
Isn't Mayor Taveras supporting you?
He let it happen. Mr. Cianci, I got to tell you, when the two of you talk,
people can't hear what you're saying, so it's useless, okay? Well, let's go back to Ted so we can continue on the pension conversation.
I want to try to keep it focused. Dr. Harrop, you've said repeatedly you want to, if you win, put the city into receivership and potentially have it file for bankruptcy as Central Falls did. Would you have Providence file for bankruptcy if you became mayor?
Well, I would certainly have it go into receivership at this particular time. We are essentially insolvent. We cannot hire enough police. We cut our ambulance runs. Our schools are not warm, safe, and dry. That's what the school department says. The city council president calls the schools appalling. The only way to fix our finances is to begin the receivership process with a competent administrator. Judge Elorza is an accountant. I have an MBA besides my MD degree. I can read the numbers. There is no way to go but through receivership and reset these horrible pensions that were agreed to. Now, the only
But receivership would not give you the ability to break contracts. Only filing for bankruptcy would. So do you need to file for bankruptcy to make your plan reality?
If the contracts cannot be renegotiated by the receiver, the hope would be that once they realize how much power the receiver has and what happened, we've litigated this with Central Falls. We don't need to go back to the courts to get answers for some of these questions. Justice Flanders and I did several appearances. He is absolutely convinced it will be a much quicker, much less costly process, and will reset the city so we can move ahead with Judge Elorza's plans, which are wonderful, but he has no money for them.
Mr. Elorza, I'll ask you to weigh in briefly. We've spent a lot of time on this, but would you consider having the city file for bankruptcy or go into receivership to straighten out its finances?
No, we can't afford to go to bankruptcy. You know, we've had cities throughout the United States go into bankruptcy. Stockton, Detroit, and Central Falls, or some form of it, receivership. And you know, the dirty little secret with receivership and bankruptcy is that what we see, particularly in Central Falls, is that that leads to tax increases. Right now, people are taxed out. We have onerous commercial tax rates, onerous property tax rates, car taxes on top of that. People are taxed out and they're on the verge of leaving the city. The only way out of this is by doing three things. First, we have to expand our tax base. We can do that through zoning. We have to bring jobs back into the city, that's second. And the last way, we have to watch every expense at City Hall. We can't give away contracts like we did many years ago. We have to watch every expense very carefully and make sure that we stretch every dollar as far as we can. That's the only way out of this, and that's my plan for the city's
future. Mr. Cianci, would you consider having the city file for receivership or bankruptcy?
No. My opponent, Dr. Harrop, he wants to do that, and he wants us to look like Detroit. And Mr. Elorza, Judge Jorge Elorza, he wants us to look like Cincinnati or Portland, wherever he wants to copy from. And I can tell you this, that he says he's an accountant. He's a Wall Street accountant. That's what he bragged about when he was at Laurel Mead. And he says, I'm a Wall Street accountant. I know how to do this. Well, there's a lot different between being a Wall Street accountant pushing phantom revenues around for millionaires than putting a budget together in City Hall for the benefit of working families in this city.
Mr. Elorza, response, please.
So I worked as an accountant in New York City for less than a year. And I came back home when I found out about my friend's death. He was 21 years old, I was 21 years old. That day, I cried for my friend, and I decided to leave my job in New York and come back down to Providence to spend the rest of my life working in the community. I'm committed to public service, and that's what brought me on this path. I have the experience of an accountant, I have the experience of a judge and a lawyer, and I'm proud to bring those talents to bear with the critical problems that we have here in the city.
All right, gentlemen, time for a topic change. We're going to go to Ed Fitzpatrick from the Providence Journal with our next question. Ed.
Mr. Harrop, our latest poll found that 90% of Providence residents are very or somewhat concerned about crime. You say you want to put more police on the streets, but you also want to put the city into receivership. So isn't it unrealistic to believe that a city in bankruptcy or receivership will be able to afford to hire more police officers, especially in the short term?
No, it's not incompatible. The problem is that you have to spend a year or two, not seven or eight, resetting the city's finances before you put them on the street. We'll graduate about 50 police shortly. They'll go into the force. Within a year, we'll be down again 100 because of retirements and the like. There is no other money to hire the police. We have to reset the pensions in order to be able to get these funding. Again, you can do a little bit with zoning. I'm very sure that Governor Fung's open for business plan will help the state, but I don't see the city correcting its own finances without the necessity of receivership.
But isn't that going to take some time to free up the money to hire more police officers?
Sure, it'll take 2 or 3 years.
And don't we need police on the streets today?
No, I said I would restore police. I didn't say today, okay? I didn't say today. We will restore police. Mayor Taveras, when he came into office, decided to avoid bankruptcy. Well, he avoided bankruptcy by laying off 100 police, by laying off ambulances, by not fixing roofs in schools. There's nothing else to cut. There's nothing in City Hall or in schools to cut at this particular time. The only thing to cut is the pension fund, and so we can save the pensions, which are quickly disappearing at this point, as well as to reset the city's contracts with various employees so that we don't have the highest public safety. We pay over $100 per person for public safety in this city. Boston spends $700, Hartford spends $600, Worcester spends $400. Those are giveaway contracts that were both Mr. Cianci's during his term and through the Democratic city councils. And neither of these guys are going to have the strength to correct the city like the Republicans will.
Mr. Elorza, you've talked about seeking more grants to try to restore the city police department to 490 officers. But the fact is Congress has slashed funding for Department of Justice programs that fund police programs, and gridlock in Congress makes renewed funding unlikely. So isn't it unrealistic to rely on the dwindling grant money to restore the police force?
The most important responsibility that any mayor has is keeping our residents safe. I have a vision for public safety that begins with every single household in the city being on a first-name basis with at least one police officer. And yes, Ed, we have to increase the number of police officers. At the end of my 8 years, if I have the honor of being elected and then re-elected, my goal is to be at 490 police officers. This is going to take a very long time, but this is why it's important. We have a new academy of police officers coming online. I want every single one of them walking the beat, riding their bicycles, getting to know the neighborhoods, the neighbors, and the community, and building those relationships. Also, I want more police officers to live here in the city. We used to have that before, and we can't require it, but we can provide incentives, just like Atlanta, just like Baltimore do, so that more police officers live in our neighborhoods and live in every one of our communities. And then the last piece, I want more diversity within the police force. We need more women and we need more minorities until we get to the point where the entire police force represents the city that it serves. And that's how we're going to build those relationships between the police department and the community.
But how do we get
now
to that?
That's all on the law enforcement side. We also know that wherever there's poverty, there's crime, and we have to address poverty directly. That means we need an aggressive jobs program, and we need to fix our schools.
But how do you get to 490 police officers? Grants run out, then the city has to pick up the payroll, the pension costs. How are you going to get there?
Well, we have to pursue these grants very aggressively. Also, we have to expand our tax base. The only way we're going to get out of this over the long term is by building up our tax base, by bringing more jobs to the city. That's why I have an aggressive jobs creation plan, working with investing in the Providence waterfront, investing in arts and culture, and investing in our small businesses and women and minority businesses as well. And we're going to aggressively pursue these grants. We used to receive about $8.5 million from the federal government.
You're getting off the topic of crime. Ed, a question for Mr.
Cianci. Mr. Cianci, you just talked about the need for greater public safety. Providence averaged 25 homicides per year during your last 4 years in office. Over the past 3 years, the city averaged 14 homicides per year, and it's had 13 so far this year. Given those facts, isn't it unrealistic to tell voters that you know what it takes to make the city safer?
All I can tell you is that when I was mayor, as I told you before, the All Cities Almanac said we're the safest city in America. We kept our police levels up to where they should have been. Those were different times, different economy, different city in many ways. And so I agree that we need to put more police officers on the street. There's no question about that. But it's how we use those police officers. And we have to have police officers. Community policing is all but dead in the city of Providence. And I started it back in the early 90s. It's all but dead because of lack of manpower. We've got to reallocate our resources and our manpower, and we should get with police officers, with community teams, go in and we're not going to arrest our way out of these problems, we're going to build our way out of these problems. Let community groups and neighborhood associations get closer to the police. Let them go to neighborhood groups, the police, and work together and structure together what a neighborhood ought to be. If they see a kid getting out of line, tell the police about it. If they see a crack house in the neighborhood, let the police know about it. Let's just not be reactionary, let's be proactive. And that's what I think can happen. My opponent, Mr. Elorza, says we're going to have an aggressive grant writing program. And he wants the city to look like Baltimore. Did he say Baltimore? Do you remember the show they had about Baltimore? It's called Homicide on television. That's what it was called. So we're going to model ourselves after you're going to model yourselves ourselves out of Baltimore. I can tell you that grants, the problem-oriented policing office at the Department of Justice is all but closed. That's where the grants came from. It's all but closed. It operates on a website now. In addition to that, there's no money, as you said when you asked the question. There is no money in Washington. Mr. Elorza, I suggest you do something. If you want more police on the city of Providence, the streets,
I'll tell you how to do this, buddy.
Your people in Congress to appropriate more money for the Safe Streets program that once kept the city safe. You ought to run for Congress, I'd even vote for you.
Mr. Elorza, a quick response.
The city of Central Falls, they hired a part-time grant writer for $30,000 a year. In his first year, he brought in over $600,000 for Central Falls. There is money out there. I don't care if I have to roll up my sleeves. I don't care if I have to fill out those applications myself. We're going to create those partnerships with our federal delegation, with private groups throughout the country, and we're going to raise the money, and we're going to bring it here to Providence.
Let's stay on this topic. I have a question for all three of you. Mr. Cianci, and I'll have all three of you answer this briefly on this topic, because we're more than halfway through this debate, believe it or not. Some people say, like Providence State Senator Paul Jabor, that we should be kicking nightclubs off of Federal Hill. Do you agree with that or disagree?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that the people who are in City Hall now and some of his supporters, they're the ones who changed the zoning uses in Federal Hill. And when that happened, chaos happened on Federal Hill. Just this morning, they had to lock down schools today. You saw that. They locked down West Broadway.
Yeah, but my question's about nightclubs on Federal
Hill. Nightclubs,
Mr.
Elorza, yeah, they should be. Yeah, exactly.
Mr. Elorza.
Yes, I also agree. We need to shut them down. You know, I used to travel around the United States, and people used to tell me if they knew two things about Rhode Island, they knew Newport and they knew Federal Hill. It's a shame that Federal Hill has lost that stature. I'm going to do everything that it takes to work with our local merchants and our residents to bring Federal Hill back to that stature where it always has been and where it should be today. Providence looks like a war zone in so many different ways. I'm going to use my honest leadership to bring safety back to every single one of our neighborhoods, and we're going to start by partnerships with the community, and Federal Hill is a prime example.
And Mr. Harrop, how do you feel about Federal Hill
nightclubs? I don't think there's any disagreement, actually, among the candidates here. Zoning and licenses botched it. The clubs need to be brought off Federal Hill where it needs to be fine dining. They need to be back down downtown where it would be appropriate to have bars.
All right, now to a section that can be physically painful for candidates. We're going to do a rapid fire section, and it's I'm looking for one word answers from each of you. Mr. Cianci, we're going to start left to right, and then I will alternate the order. Mr. Cianci, A through F, letter grade for Providence Mayor Angel Taveras.
I give him a B, B minus, only because he didn't finish the job.
Mr. Elorza?
I for incomplete.
And Mr. Harrop?
D minus.
Mr. Elorza, yes or no, under the current deals, is the city getting enough money from nonprofits like Brown University?
No.
Mr. Harrop?
No.
And Mr. Cianci?
I think that we have to look at Brown University and all the institutions. We get $24 million
a year. Is that a no, Mr. Cianci?
I think it's a maybe that they can do a little bit more for us because we do a lot with them and for them if they contribute a great deal to the economy of Rhode Island.
Mr. Harrop, I owe you some time in this debate, so tell me, a follow-up to this question, would you reopen the deals before they expire, and who do you think should be giving more money of the nonprofits?
I think that we need to negotiate with, I think they all need to give more. I think they need to give it in a different way. I really think we need to work with them as partners and not consider them to be piggy banks. Our colleges are educational institutions. Our schools are a disaster. We have other fine arts and cultural nonprofits. Could be a growing industry here. So we need to partner with them, and they need to use the money, not to give us cash, but to use it internally to help the city in various ways.
All right, back to rapid fire. Mr. Harrop, we'll stick with you. Yes or no, would you support adding more charter schools in the city of Providence?
Absolutely.
Mr. Cianci?
No.
And Mr. Elorza?
It depends. They all apply individually. There are high-achieving charter schools. There are low-performing charter schools. It's about seeing what charter schools are doing well, how they're doing it, and then the most
that
important question
is like a yes.
How can we bring it into the public schools?
Can I elaborate?
Traditional public schools have to be the priority.
All right. Let's get through this section. I'm sure you'll elaborate a lot more throughout the debate. Mr. Cianci, who are you supporting for governor?
At this time, Tim White. I think he'd be a great candidate.
Of the candidates on the ballot.
I think both candidates have good news. I think they're both competent, and I think that they both have stories to tell and records of achievement. I'm an independent, so I'm going to keep my vote to myself.
Okay. Mr. Elorza, I think I know your answer, but who are you supporting for governor?
Gina Raimondo, and I look forward to working together to create jobs, fix our schools, and bring honest leadership to the city.
And Mr. Harrop.
Alan Fung.
Okay, final question, rapid fire.
I guess I'm the deciding factor here then, right?
Mr. Elorza, I want to, again, rapid fire streetcars. Do you support or oppose Mayor Angel Tavares' plan for a streetcar line in Providence?
I love the vision. We're a long way before we can adequately say we're going to be able to fund it.
But you support the idea of streetcars?
Sure, the idea is
okay.
Great.
Mr. Harrop, do you support or oppose Mayor Tavares' plan for a streetcar line?
Oppose. It's wasteful. Buses can take that stuff.
Do you agree with that? Support or oppose?
At $50 million a mile, I'd have a better use for that $50 million of city money than to build a trolley car.
All right, let's go to Ted Nisi from WPRI.com.
Maybe with a high-speed rail.
Mr. Cianci, we'll actually stick with you on this, and it's a topic that's come up earlier in the debate, the waterfront. You recently told the Greater Providence Chamber of Commerce you do not support having heavy industrial companies continue to use the waterfront the way they are now. So what do you think should be done there?
Yes, I'll tell you what. Everything south of Thurbis Avenue could be a working waterfront. But right now what we have there is strip clubs and we have scrap metal yards. What I propose is a mixed use of opportunity there. What we need to do is bring in companies that will use that, cruise ships, buildings, all that is such an important part. Right now, the scrap metal yard there employs about 6 or 7 people on a ship. In the whole port, there's 60 or 70 people working. It gives about $600,000 a year in taxes. And in addition to that, look who moved out. Stereo Automotive moved out. Verizon moved out. Cumberland Farms tore their building down ever since they put the scrap metal there. We need to have a working waterfront. Yes, I totally agree. And remember back years ago, I proposed the Three Cities program, and one was that new city program called Narragansett Landing. It was a marvelous program. It would have provided hundreds and hundreds of jobs and provided a lot of tax revenues. That area should be giving us $10, $12 million in tax revenue. We're getting $600,000. It's not the highest and best use for the land. We were robbed of our waterfront. We don't have access to it, and it's about time we reclaimed it from the robber barons who stole it from us years ago.
All right, don't clap, please, audience. Mr. Elorza, unlike Mr. Cianci, you told the chamber you do support having heavy industrial companies continue to use the Providence waterfront. Why do you disagree with Mr. Cianci's vision?
I absolutely support a working waterfront. We have one of only two deep water ports in all of New England. It truly is one of our greatest resources. You know, they say that it's so underutilized, the working waterfront is so underutilized that it's as if we built the highway and then used the highway only as a bike lane. That's how underutilized the working waterfront is. Right now, the Panama Canal is expanding. The eastern seaboard will likely see more traffic. We need to be out ahead and allow for heavy industrial use in our waterfront. We see the growth in Quonset and in Davisville. We can't continue to miss out on economic opportunities. I want to bring jobs back into the city. And I proposed a plan several months ago. I want to double our exports over the next 5 years. And if we do this right, it'll create as many as 1,500 good working class, middle class jobs in our waterfront. It's an underutilized opportunity, and I look forward to being in the lead and developing it. I've spoken with our federal delegation. They're excited about it as well. I'm going to provide the honest leadership to get it done.
What are we going to export?
There are many things we can export.
What are we going to
please
export?
Please answer then.
Oh, hey, what are we going to export?
There's a lot that we're going to export.
I think so you said used cars to is Cape Verde.
Mr. Cianci, you asked a question. Let him answer
the question. Let him answer.
That's what you told me.
Yep.
Used cars. That's going to a lot of jobs there.
Used cars are increasing. There are a number of industries. You know, we are exporting scrap metal.
And with the car tax,
I realize you're very comfortable with a microphone after many years behind one. But let's let Mr. Elorza answer the question. Thank you.
Go ahead.
We are still manufacturing here in the city. And let's look at all of the ways that we can export goods and services. I met with folks from the working waterfront today, and they were telling me that part of what they're exporting are also consulting services. They've learned how to do port security, and they're selling this to emerging countries throughout the world that are just getting into the import-export business. Let's be creative. Let's leverage our talent and our resources, and let's find goods and services to export. Another area, Rhode Island is becoming a hub for design services. Very easy to export, but we have to get out there to the rest of the world, and we have to build these relationships first. Let's connect Providence's economy to the rest of the world. That's the way forward, and we're going to bring jobs to the city.
Mr. Cianci, that may sound good to a lot of people at home. What's the problem you see in Mr. Elorza's plan for that?
I think that, you know, he speaks very eloquently, but doesn't say anything. I'd like to know what we're going to export and where we're going to export it. You know, he talked about a deep water port. When I was mayor, we made it a deep water port. We dredged the Burris to 40 feet. We used it as much as we had. We brought container cranes in, and we brought cars in. And frankly, right now, the port, I'm not saying don't make the port a working port. I say make it a working port, but you don't have to utilize all the land there for the working port. We have very little waterfront, precious waterfront in the city of Providence, and we should take advantage of it.
All right, I want to bring in Mr. Harrop. On your website, you say you support, quote, development along our currently vastly underdeveloped waterfront. Do you agree more with Mr. Cianci's vision or Mr. Elorza's on this?
I think that they're going down is the route that got us into the 38 Studios trouble, which was to trying to pick winners and losers to put down there at this particular time. I really support simplifying the zoning, simplifying the permitting, reducing the property taxes there, passing a municipal right-to-work ordinance, and then to let the free market really take over the port down there. That's the best way to develop the port without trying to pick a winner or a loser and without getting into what has been the policy for the last 30 years, picking political people, political friends, to run certain businesses.
Mr. Harrop, before I go to Ed, I got to ask you, how would you ever get a right-to-work ordinance through Providence City Council?
I don't know that I will, but I think if I was elected mayor, that would send a clear signal to the City of Providence Council that the people are willing to consider that.
All right, we're running short on time. I want to cover a few more topics. Ed.
This is a question from a viewer. What is the best thing that Angel Taveras did during his 4 years as mayor, and what is the biggest policy difference between you and Mr. Taveras? And let's start with Mr. Elorza.
The best thing that he did was save the city from bankruptcy. You know, we were facing truly a Category 5 hurricane. And he came in and was decisive on day one. He was fiscally responsible from the very beginning, and he turned the finances around so that we're not facing imminent insolvency anymore. So that was the greatest accomplishment. The key difference, while I mentioned a great deal about my vision to invest in the working waterfront, so I'll mention something else, and it's support for the communities. You know, there was the whole debacle around closing the Davy Lopes pool. Right now, when our kids are shooting at each other, right now, when our streets are facing significant blight, we have to be providing more and better opportunities for our young people. That's why I've said that if I'm remembered for one thing, I want to be remembered as the person who turned around these schools, and I want to create opportunities for our kids through full-service community schools. That means making sure that opportunities are accessible to them, not just during the day, but also during the evening, during the weekends, and during the summer as well.
Thank you, Mr. Elorza. We have to move along.
Mr. Harrop.
I gave him a D- earlier, so that's going to be difficult, the first part. He gave us some breathing room. The pension fund had dropped to 31% funded when he came in office. It's still 31% funded. So there was some financial wiggle room he gave us at that time, but I don't think avoiding bankruptcy was a good idea. I think his biggest problem was he avoided the educational system. No matter what you can say, the schools are not safe. They're not good learning situation for our children. They continue at the bottom of ranking statewide. He put little to no time into trying to work on the educational system, and that will have grave repercussions for the city in the future.
Mr. Cianci.
Yes, I think that you said your question was, I even forgot it now that we've been through so long a period of time here. But basically, what do I agree with Mr. Elorza?
Yeah, the best thing he did, and the biggest policy.
I have to agree that he saved the city from bankruptcy. When the Cicilline administration left office, it was $110 million structural deficit, and I think that he had a yeoman's job to cobble something together to make that a better situation for the city, and he did. What I regret that he did was fire 2,200 teachers. I thought that was a bad move. And I think that it just ruined the morale of teachers, it ruined the morale of the school system, and it frankly should not have happened. It could have happened in another way. I think it was done the wrong way. I also think that he decimated the police department, and that's why we have public safety problems that we have today. Just this morning, they shut down West Broadway School because it was gunshots. We all saw the newspaper, your newspaper, that said that, well, the headline today, 19 or whatever, 15 shootings and stabbings in 19 hours, whatever it was. Those are the kinds of things we can't stand, because in economic development, if you want to develop a port, build a neighborhood, you've got to have police to go out and make those relationships. And we are not going to bring business here. We are not going to attract anybody. No one's going to want to stay here. They are going to move. And if we don't have safe streets, that's the first thing you have to consider with economic development, safety.
Mr. Cianci, we have about 5 minutes before we're going to give you your closing statements, all three of you. Mm-hmm. And I got a big topic here, so I'm going to try and keep you all to about a minute, minute and a half on each of these answers. Education. Look, by any metric you want to look at, graduation rates, test scores, attendance, the city of Providence school system is underperforming, to put it politely. Diagnose, Mr. Cianci, the city's schools.
I think the culture of the school system is wrong. I think the culture has to be changed. How do I mean? If a parent wants to go in the school administrator's building to talk about curriculum, talk about busing, talk about registration, they almost have to bring a lawyer with them. And that's not right. Number two, we don't educate the kids the way we ought to today. The paradigm is different. Today, you know, I was having dinner up in a restaurant and four college kids that graduated from college. They came, they said, "Mayor, take a picture, and I did. I sat down with them. They told me they had $120,000 of debt and no job. And why? Because we educate kids the wrong way. We don't have enough guidance in our school system so that we can take these kids when they're younger and see what they're interested in. When they get to 11th grade or so, you know, if they want to be a CNA, and get a relationship with Rowland Hospital. If they want to work at NORAD to assess rising cars, get an apprenticeship there. If they want to work at Electric Boat to be a welder, train them for that. Get them an apprenticeship so when they get out of high school, they've got a job that's paying them $30 and $40 an hour. They don't have debt, and they have something that they can do and they're interested in. Ask a kid today, a lot of them, what is school? Boring, they'll tell you. So make it more interesting for them. The other thing that we have to do is make sure that we have more autonomy in the schools. Make sure that we have the principals and we have the teachers who can make the decisions. They have to get permission to take a field trip for kids. And those are the kinds of things that we should look at. I also can tell you that busing is out of hand in this city.
Please.
Yeah, busing is out of hand. Kids spend 4 hours a day. They're going to be bus drivers when they grow up. And then we have to go to neighborhood schools and make those neighborhood schools work so we won't have the busing and we'll have a neighborhood school a kid can go to
almost
and learn.
Out of time. Mr. Elorza, a big topic, but I need you to weigh in.
Absolutely. I believe in full-service community schools. Full-service community schools begins with the idea that right now we're using our school buildings for less than half of the day, and we're using them for less than half of the year. It's such an inefficient use of space. What I'd like to do is open the doors of the school buildings. We've already built them. We already maintain them. We already heat them during the winter. Let's leave them open for the community to use. For example, let's provide perhaps English classes for parents. Let's use a community group that already does it. Let's bring them into the school building. And let's synchronize those classes with the instruction that their kids receive during the day so that the parents can help the children with their homework during the evenings.
How are you going to pay for
that? I believe in the full service. It's a very cost-effective model. It's been done in other places. You know, what it takes is you have to open up the schools. But the services, they're already provided by the community. What I'm proposing is that those services be provided inside the school building. The second part of full-service community schools is the community school piece of it. I want kids to go to their neighborhood community schools. I want to engage the community and engage their parents in what happens in the building, and that only happens if they go to their community schools and not get bused from one side of the city to the next. There's so much that we have to do in education. But I believe that with this model, it's been done in other places, it's been extremely effective, and it's high time that we bring it here to Providence. And the last piece I have to mention with education,
almost out of time. Mr.
We spend
Harrop,
so much with
in.
Central management, we have to push it out to the schools.
Thank you. I think The Republicans are proposing market changes in the educational system. We have schools that are appalling per the city council president. We have schools that are not warm, safe, and dry, says the school department. We need $1 billion to bring up the schools to 19th century standards, where the roofs are safe and the windows closed, not 21st century standards. The Republicans are proposing a vast array of educational choice, from certified homeschooling to charter schools, as many as we can, to means-tested vouchers to pull out. I think it is immoral that we are asking our children to enter these buildings at this time, and it is immoral for children to be assigned a school based on their zip code.
All right, I have very little time to play with here if I would want to get you to each say your closing statement. So I want to take a step back here. We've covered a lot of policy issues here tonight, and I want to ask you a question within 30 seconds each that may be telling about your perspective on the city. If someone was going on a first date in Providence, Mr. Elorza, where would you tell them to go?
Los Andes restaurant.
Why?
You know, they serve some of the best food in the city, but it's also, you know, two young kids, two Bolivian kids who have been in the restaurant business all their life, just good, hardworking kids looking to do better. They're entrepreneurs. They do wonderful work, and it also showcases, you know, the great cuisine that we have here in the city.
All right, Mr. Cianci, where would you tell people
I would
to go?
Say any restaurant in the city of Providence is
Come
terrific.
On.
And you know why it's terrific? Because we started a culinary scene here years ago. When we had the convention center built, we realized we didn't have enough restaurants. And so we started a Providence Economic Development Corporation that gave 1% loans to restaurants. They rehab buildings, and some of those restaurants you know about, good ones, Cafe Nuovo is one of them. Vende Ravioli is another one. We did about 60 or 70 of them. So having participated in that program, I think that I would have to go to every single
one. I thought you would have said Waterfire in that one. Mr. Harrop.
Well, Waterfire is a great thing.
I like my little neighborhood bar, Tortilla Flats. It's up on the east side. It's on Hope Street. It's a fun place. It's great food, and I would really suggest people try it.
All right. Well, I needed to have a little levity in this heavy debate. Now each of the candidates will have a chance to make their closing remarks and a reminder to our live audience. We need you to hold your applause until the very end of the debate. So each candidate can have their say. Again, the order for closing statements was determined by a drawing, and we begin with Daniel Harrop. Mr. Harrop, your closing remarks.
As you've heard tonight, we Republicans are proposing a complete plan for the city of Providence. Vast educational changes with educational choice. We're proposing to reduce and eliminate car taxes. We're proposing to restore the police, not tomorrow, but within the course of 2 or 3 years, when we can stabilize the financial condition of the city. $2 billion deficit in the pension fund, $1 billion needed for schools. We have the highest commercial tax rates in the nation for 2 of the last 3 years, and we can't fill the potholes. The financial aspects are really what is key here at this point. For 30 plus years, it's been you gotta know a guy to get something done in City Hall. And whether it's Mr. Cianci or the Democrats, there hasn't really been much of a change. We Republicans will make the significant change that the city needs, and I would urge you to vote Republican this November.
All right, thank you, Mr. Harrop. Now, Mr. Elorza, please, your 60-second closing remarks.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, everyone watching at home. I've been a judge here in the city, and as a judge, I brought all of the biggest banks in the world. I brought them into my court to take responsibility for the abandoned properties we have here in Providence. They were too big to care about our city, but I brought them in and I made them care. I found them in contempt. I even had to threaten to arrest the presidents of Bank of America and Deutsche Bank until they came in and took responsibility. That's the fight that I'm going to bring, regardless of how large the institution. I'm going to fight for our residents here in the city of Providence, and I'm going to do it with honest leadership to bring jobs to every neighborhood in our city, to fix our schools, and to create a culture at City Hall that just works for the taxpayers. It would be an honor to serve as your next mayor, and if I have the honor of not just being elected, but also reelected, I look forward to working every day and thinking long-term about how to make this city great.
Thank you, Mr. Elorza. Now, Mr. Cianci, your 60-second closing remarks.
You know, my opponent's campaign is supported and staffed by people who gave the city a decade of decline. I represent new policies and a new vision. I was mayor before. I loved being mayor of the city of Providence, and I'll tell you why. We were able to work together to take a city. And people ask me all the time, when you were mayor, what's the best thing you ever did for the city or that your administration did? They say, oh, is it helping to fix the zoo or helping to put Barnaby Evans water fire up? Or is it building the Providence Place Mall? Or is it embracing historic preservation? They ask me those questions all the time. And I say, no, it's none of those things. What it really is the fact that we took a city and we made that city a proud city again. We raised the self-esteem of people, the city of Providence, to levels they never thought they could achieve. We had our own show on NBC. We created the film industry. We brought in the Providence Bruins. We built a convention center, built the hotels, and I can do it again. That was economic development. That was economic development that truly people in Providence loved. And I can tell you this. I know Providence's best days are still ahead. Together, let's write the next chapter in Providence's history, a chapter of safe streets, more jobs, and better schools. And that's what you'll get when I'm mayor.
Thank you, Mr.
Cianci.
And now to our live audience, you can applaud the candidates. Thank Rhode Island College for hosting this debate, and that does it for campaign 2014, our Providence mayoral debate. Be sure to watch Eyewitness News at 10 o'clock on Fox Providence and at 11 on WPRI 12 for a complete wrap-up of tonight's debate, as well as expert analysis. You can also follow our campaign 2014 coverage on WPRI.com. You'll find our latest Eyewitness News Providence Journal poll there as well. And in just a few weeks, Eyewitness News and the Providence Journal will bring yet another live campaign 2014 debate, October 21st at 7 p.m. from the Providence Performing Arts Center, a debate among the major candidates for governor, Alan Fung, Robert Healey, and Gina Raimondo. Debate the issues exactly 2 weeks from Election Day. Go online to reserve a seat or submit your questions at WPRI.com. And no one is bringing you more debates than Eyewitness News. We have some marquee matchups all next month, starting with a debate among the candidates for Attorney General that will air Sunday, October 12th, and our final debate among the major candidates for Lieutenant Governor, and that will air on Sunday, November 2nd. Well, for Ted Nesi and Ed Fitzpatrick, I'm Tim White. Good night from Rhode Island College.